Welcome to a new edition of the Neon Jazz Interview Series with New York jazz vocalist Grace Haggerty. She opened up about her latest 2021 CD, My Funny Valentine, featuring an ensemble of great musicians like John Fedchock, along with a full-string ensemble. She was influenced at a young age by her family. Her father was a classically trained pianist, and her mother was a ballerina. She always dreamed of being a singer from a very early age. Get to know her. Enjoy the story.
Thanks for taking a minute out for Neon Jazz today. I appreciate it.
Oh, thank you for having me, Joe. This is very exciting.
Right on. So let's start off with, you know, there's a couple of different ways of looking at what it means to put an album out during this time. I was thinking about last year when no one knew the world was going to just come to a grinding halt. And there was a lot of CDs that were coming through and, you know, the timing, people were kind of stuck in it. But I'm seeing a lot of albums that are coming out now and I'm having flashbacks. But it's good, positive. I think that it's proof that the world is continuing to turn. So my question to you as we begin this is, any ambiguity, ambivalence, anything that went into the timing of this new album?
No, not really. I just love recording and love singing, able to put the album out. I did record it and finish it last year, and I just thought the timing would be right now to pop it out for, you know, through production. Basically, no, I was able to continue singing during COVID. I was able to come to Tiki Recording Studio. He had everything set up with caution, masks, and, you know, it was very private getting into the booth. He was in another spot, so I've continued through the COVID. I'm one of the lucky ones. I had it and I wanted to put it out for everyone to hear. And I thought it would be a good time because everyone is listening now.
Yeah, well, that's the other part of this too. When the pandemic began, it was like, you know, you can release an album, but you can't back this up with any live performances. But I think that's evolved into 2021 being, at this point, putting this out, this is almost like having a set of live shows.
It's moved us forward, you know, to be more into the internet and Instagram and that kind of thing. But, you know, Fred has kind of moved me along also because he's introduced me to all these amazing musicians and they've all been available during COVID. So... we've been able to move forward. We're doing another album right now. We're in the process, and we're just moving on.
You know, when this began, too, I remember I'm on a listserv, and somebody was saying, you know, here's a dream list of musicians you can try to get interviews with because everybody's available. And I think that's been a part of the silver lining for the jazz world is that these sessions that would never ever happen before because everybody in the old world was moving so fast finally got to slow down and people had the chance to recalibrate what they wanted to do and how they wanted to do it. And I noticed on My Funny Valentine, you got John Fedchock and you got a pretty power lineup of musicians on this recording. Talk about the conversation, talk about what it was like to have this ensemble of musicians on this project.
Incredible. Just so lucky to have worked with Fred and Angelo DiPippo. They really brought these musicians to me, and I'm so lucky to work with them. Fred, you can elaborate a little bit further on that because you're the one who really set all that up for me, and I'm grateful.
My pleasure, Grace. We just it's funny at this point during this COVID, how many people are available, as you said, Joe. It's scary, but yet it's kind of, what's nice about it, it's kind of brings us all together in a nice way because their schedules usually are packed, and now they're all available. So, but yet it brings us together with some kind of an unity because we're all in the same boat. So we're like, well, let's get in and make some music together. And we've exercised caution with mask wearing and what. Of course, they can't do that when they're playing their horns. But we put up big barriers and things like that. And we're just going forward with caution.
And that's all you can really do. I mean, we've got a monopoly down here. I don't think anybody wants to look back and think, man, it was wasted time because, you know, technology and other wherewithal have given us that luxury of being able to do that. So when somebody buys or downloads this album and really gets involved in this experience, what do you want them to feel? How do you want them to walk away from this project you put out?
Of course, feeling the emotion of all of these incredible musicians, what they're putting out. And then, you know, my vocal is a little more, I guess, emotional a little deeper than, I hope that that's what they're feeling. These songs I grew up with. My dad was a classically trained pianist, and we grew up with music in the house every single day. And I just, he's passed 5 years ago, but I just miss that. I mean, he would just walk in my house and just plop on the piano for hours. That was really what enlightened me as a child. You know, it just puts all these colors in your mind, and you just move forward with the emotion from the music. And I hope that people listen to this and feel that. You know, they feel colors and they feel emotion.
What was the first show you saw live that, like, jazz show that really blew you away and made you think that's something you want to do with your life?
Ooh, I would say it was my dad and I watching, you know, Ella Fitzgerald on the television. I think that would probably be the first time. We didn't get into the city much growing up on Long Island in New York. But we were watching these people on television 24/7 as much as we possibly could.
You know, I got to say, just kind of as a quick aside, I've noticed the accent, and I know sometimes people wonder, how did a Domino end up in Kansas City? My dad was born in Brooklyn and raised in Babylon up there in Massapequa, Long Island.
Wow.
Yeah.
Oh, that's so fabulous.
Yeah. I don't know where that's at.
We have accents.
Yes, you do.
Oh, my gosh. But not
yeah.
On the album, right? You can't hear it when I'm singing.
No, no, it's like okay. The Beatles. It's like, wait, they're English? Yeah, no, it's fine.
All right.
But,
oh, my gosh, I didn't think I had an accent.
Oh, man, and I love that. I remember when I went up there, I think it was in 87. It was around the time my grandfather was, he was pretty sick, and we went up kind of for a final visit, and there's several things that I remember. More specifically, I remember my aunt and uncle owned a pastry shop, Severoli Pastry, and my dad's weakness was sugar, so he would get a box to fly back here, and he would eat the whole thing by the time he got to LaGuardia.
Oh,
he would just, he'd be a mess. He'd have powdered sugar all over him, like he just went through a sugar war. But,
oh my gosh, jelly donuts.
Oh, my, yeah, I mean, he had cannoli, and there was all of those old-school Italian pastries. But I remember at that time, the Buttafuoco thing was going on, and I used to love, from being from Kansas City in the Midwest, listening to all of those guys. My Uncle Rico was the biggest bullshit artist, and he'd get back with those guys, and they would be like, that goddamn Buttafuoco, and they would go on and on and on, and
that's
they would
funny.
Just... they would have me in stitches, and I wish that I would have recorded it because it was like the precursor to these internet shows with like Cake Boss people talking, and they were just a riot. So anyway,
Joey Buttafuoco is that his brother is Bobby Buttafuoco is a drummer, and I was recording his band at the same time that Joey was going through that whole legal thing.
Oh, wow.
Well, yeah, so Bobby was at the studio one night, and I get this, I mean, Bobby, the drummer, was at the studio one night, and I get this phone call. It's like, hey, is Bobby there? And I go, and I kind of had a feeling who it was, and I said, who's calling? He goes, oh, it's Joey.
It's his brother, Joey.
I'm like, oh.
That was...
oh, gosh.
It's sort of, like, sort of like making, you know, a folklore, like with the whole, you know, any of the gangster kind of thing, you know?
Right, totally. Well, and then, you know, they would see a Baldwin brother up there. There was always something that was kind of brewing and, you know, it was kind of salacious, but it was fun, you know. And the accents definitely recognizable. But I always find it funny being here in Kansas City in the cradle of jazz interviewing a lot of musicians. so many of them come from that area, and I always, it always brings me back to that. My dad was all from there.
You miss it at all, New York?
You know, I didn't spend much time, but I absolutely loved it. You know, and my cousin Maria was a real hipster, so she took me up there and was like showing me places where, you know, Joan Jett would go to the CBGB and all these people. And I remember when we went up there, and I went up there before, like in 98, and we did like the tour and the double-decker bus, and she was so cool. She kept ducking like, I hope to God no one sees me. I'm like, Jesus Christ, we're in New York. We're in the big city in the world. What do you mean? You know, because I'm coming from like a small town, Liberty, Missouri, and maybe Kansas City. You probably will run into people. But I'm thinking, New York, this is the epicenter of Earth. Who's going to see you? But that's just, you know, how she rolled. But anyway, I didn't spend a whole lot of time, but I loved it. I loved the urban jungle, and it blew my mind because I'd never seen anything like that. I mean, being in, like, coming from Kansas City and standing in the middle of Manhattan when it's bright sunshine and you're in the dark for 45 minutes because the buildings are blocking the sun is just a totally different thing. It's an environmental shock. But I loved it. I loved all the people. And, you know, growing up, you know, here watching movies, you just see all these images from the 70s of herds of people crossing the street and this whole thing that you can't even comprehend until you get in the middle of it. So it was invigorating. And I, on the side, I paint and I write. So like being infused with that kind of artistic energy is like, holy, this is wonderful.
Well,
so,
I majored in art, believe it or not. I don't do anything with my art, but, yeah, so it's all the same thing, right? And my mother was ballerina. I mean, you know, a perpetual love for ballet. And but I hope you get back here. I'll be performing by that time in the city, and you'll come and see me.
Absolutely. And I'm cultivating so many relationships with musicians that I couldn't imagine seeing like a show at the Village Vanguard. I remember interviewing a musician. I can't remember his name now. And it was one of the best stories that I had ever heard. I think he was from Detroit. And I was like, what was it like when you saw a show in New York for the first time? And he said that he saw, I think it was Coleman. There was a big name that he saw. Mm-hmm. And he came upstairs from the staircase and walked out. And he looked around New York and he literally just fainted. Just collapsed like a sack of potatoes. He was in such shock. And I think, if I get the chance to get there and see something like that, I'm going to be kind of in the same boat because I just can't imagine going to one of those hallowed institutions that I've thought about and seen and heard about so much and seeing that. I mean, we have 18 and Vine, but that day is over. It's almost like a baton's been passed on, but it took 4 years for the runner to catch that baton. Whereas in New York City, that continual race has gone on and on and on and on. But that's been the interesting thing about this pandemic is that when I think about the annals of all of these jazz cradles from New Orleans to Kansas City to New York, Kansas City probably had the longest run on the planet of continual jazz because when Pendergast was here, the booze was flowing and we didn't stop. The rest of the country stopped. So we didn't have a break. This is the
No wonder you'll never leave Kansas.
Right. Yeah, there's always a drink and there's jazz. What are you going to do?
A lot of fun going on. Well,
yeah,
and a little dead right now. You know, it's eerie, but it'll come back. It just needs a little time. You know, we've all got to get back out there and not be afraid and just go forward. But and did you get a chance to listen to Quiet Nights, Quiet Stars, with Angelo DiPippo with the accordion? That's kind of a really I thought it kind of a genius song there. We had done the recording with guitar, and then Angelo said that he'd like to play the accordion on there, and at first I was a little like, I don't know, does this fit? And then I absolutely love it. So that's one I think I would love for you to listen to at some point.
Yeah, well, and the accordion is kind of one of those instruments, like, it's not something you associate as strongly with the repertoire, but those instruments really do. Yeah, you know, they just really add punch to everything. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I guess I got off track there. I just, once I hear Long Island, I'm like, my geography is getting just skewed. My next question to you is this, you know, you've had influences in your life, and you've been around musicians. What have they given you that you in turn have given to players that are younger than you on the bandstand? What is the by osmosis education that you've gotten that you've translated into a mentorship for others that are around you?
When you ask me that question, the first thing that comes to mind is that I have grandchildren, and when they were born and I was taking care of them, I would play classical music in my car, and now they're 7, 8, and 9. There's 4 of them, and they all know most of the classic songs. They could sing them. They can. I open them up to standards and like Sound of Music and Over the Rainbow and just some of these classic songs, and now they love music. So when you say that's what comes to mind, is that the children having music in their lives, I really feel like that opens so many pieces of their brain, and I really think it starts with the children, so I'm very proud to say that I've instilled the love of music to these 4 little kids, and hopefully they'll go on to become musicians, or learn to play an instrument, which they all are right now. But that's what comes to mind.
Yeah, that's wonderful. And I remember when my son was getting ready to be born, and there was a lot of music, and I remember hearing that. And I thought about that during this COVID, and I'd like to pitch an idea to Spielberg. And it would be this: when when everything shut down in like March and April, I'm sure there was a lot of kids that were being conceived. And I bet you a lot of money, like
true.
With this classical music thing, I bet you there was a lot of voices in the home that were never there before. And I bet there was a lot of music. And I would wonder if these kids, when they're born, have a superior level of intelligence, and maybe it can be turned into a movie where in 20 years from after they're born, they come up with some superior antidote that will prevent our planet from going through a viral pandemic again. And they can be called the COVID kids. Something like that.
Cool.
Yeah, you never know.
Pretty cool. So,
but I thought about it in that vein of playing music for the kids. These kids went through, everything slowed down, and it's kind of like when animals flee an earthquake. I think the inverse happens with something that happened on the planet, like the canals of Venice cleared up, Beijing's air got clean for the first time and God knows how long. So everything has their way of like sending energy through what we live. And I would be very interested with these COVID kids, what's going to transpire possibly mentally for them as they get older.
I agree with you. And I just think it brought everyone back to basic home, family, what's really important. I think it did have a lot of good. There were a lot of bad that happened, all the deaths and sickness. But out of everything bad, there is something that comes good, right? Bring us all to a different spot. But I agree with that. That's interesting. But I always played my one son. He wouldn't sleep, as a child until I put Vivaldi on.
Oh, yeah.
But music does wonderful things, I think.
It's the best language. It's the unifier, for sure.
I couldn't live without it. So I come into the studio as much as I can, and I'm lucky to have all of these wonderful people around me. And I've been so blessed. I can't say that enough, because I really have. I've just put one foot in front of the other, starting later in life, always having the dream, and I've been lucky enough to have the right fit, meeting Fred from another piano player. Then going forward, we did a little Christmas album just to get our feet wet, and then I met Angelo through Fred, and so here we are today. And
right on.
Hopefully you'll be playing my next album.
What do you miss the most from the old world that has gone away from, say, March 2020, that you would like to get back to whenever things kind of start returning?
I'd like to go out to dinner.
Yeah. Yep.
I'd like to be waited on.
The little thing.
A lot of cooking.
Yeah.
And being out, you know, listening to the music, and, you know, I was going to the Carlisle, and before this happened, I was at the Carlisle the month before, listening. Oh, my gosh. So I definitely miss the music. You know, being out in it and encompassing the sound while you're sitting there with, oh, my gosh, it just, it does something to me.
Well, I know in Kansas City, we've kind of hit a renaissance before this happened, and we have some really swinging places, and my wife and I love to go see jazz, and I think about a month ago, we were like, my God, this is, it's crazy. We just really, we've longed for it the whole time, but we really have hit a point where it's like, man, this is crazy. I mean, there were some socially distant shows this summer, but like, as far as like in Kansas City, I'm sure in New York, you know, any night you look on the calendar, there's like 20, 30 things going on, literally, you know? So I guess with that in mind, when we do return and things start picking back up and the crowds come back and the musicians return, what do you hope we realize about this absence of live music? Something that we hold on to, that we carry with us as we move on.
I would say go for your passion. You know, your passion makes you happy and it's inside of you. You know, move forward with your passion. Don't be afraid. Life is short. You know, move on. Keep put one foot in front of the other and accomplish something, you know. I mean, I don't know if that answers your question, but I don't, you know, I just feel like home, family, music, food, friends, book, the basics. Life is not that complicated. It's people that make it complicated, and just move forward. Well, you've been so nice to me. Fred, I haven't heard anything from you. Are
sure,
you good?
This is your interview. I'm just here to lend some moral support.
Well, this is really open, too. That's the thing about a tandem interview. Any time you want to jump in, I'm kind of throwing it out there for the gallery. So if there's anything that really kind of comes to mind, please chime in. That's totally fine.
Actually, I'll offer this to the interview. I will say this, that working with Grace has really been great, and I'll tell you why. She wants things right, and, you know, as producers of the record, Angelo and I, Angelo is a wonderful arranger. He's been in the business for years, and we can really tell you, because he'll get mad if I tell you how many. He is an award-winning jazz accordion player. Besides being the arranger of this record, he has won awards as being the best accordion jazz accordion player in the United States, and he's a wonderful, incredible player. But you know, with Grace as an artist, she gives us permission to get the best that we can get in the way of musicians and do our best. And it's always nice not to have restrictions on what we can do. And she just says, just make it right. I want my record right. And she said, you know, and so we get to bring in the greatest players in New York. Most of the players that we work with, for example, the string players, they're all like Met players, New York Met players, and not the New York Mets in terms of baseball, but and most of the brass players and woodwinds, we get the Broadway players. They're fantastic, and as I was saying before, they're all available now, which is kind of sad but nice. And but it also is a great camaraderie, and we all get along, and they welcome the work. They love working for Grace, and they love working on Angelo's arrangements because they're just brilliant. And as I said, she gives us the permission to kind of do it right, and that's just, you can't ask anything more than that.
So I guess that kind of leads me into what my final question and thought here is. You know, everyone has a perception of you, your family, your friends, your fans, but you are living your life. Who do you think you are?
Fred, who are you?
No, it's who are you?
Turn the tables.
Who am I? I'm ever evolving. That's who I am. And I never want to be somebody to, I'm just evolving, going through life one foot in front of the other. I I hope I'm a kind person. That's the most important thing to me.
Perfect. That's a great way to wrap it up. Hey, thank you.
Thank
both
you so
for
much, Joe. I hope you have a great day.
Thanks for listening and tuning in to another Neon Jazz interview, where we give you a bit of insight into the finest singers in New York, Kansas City, and spots all over the world, giving fans all that jazz. And thanks to Grace for her time, music, and stories. If you want to hear more interviews, go to Famous Interviews with Joe Domino in the iTunes store. Visit NeonJazz at YouTube.com. And for everything Neon Jazz all the time, go to the NeonJazz.blogspot.com. Until next time, enjoy the jazz, my friends.
Neon Jazz.